Alright, so we're out on our hiking trip this weekend. Got Medic Jim back there behind me. Got Howie and Chris up ahead of me. And using my Dixon roller pack behind me. It's working out great. Really nice, especially going up this long trail uphill. It's nice to have the weight on the ground rather than on my back. I don't know where we are, so I'll have to ask Howie or Jim later where we are, because I don't know, I didn't even drive here. I just hopped in the truck with Jim, and he took me to Howie's house, and then we hopped in the truck with Howie, and he brought me out here. So for all I know, they're gonna leave me for dead somewhere, and nah, I'm kidding. Anyways, now I've known these guys for a couple of years now. They're all good friends. So we'll be coming back in. It's Friday afternoon now. We'll be staying out till Sunday afternoon. And weather's supposed to be nice until Sunday. So there's Jim there, bringing up the rear. And looks like a nice place. Somewhere in the Pennsylvania mountains. So alrighty, talk to you later. Somewhere over here is a really big deer. You can hear him walking. I think he's over there. Maybe we can get him on a camera. Can you see him? I heard him too, but he's in there somewhere. Really getting into the wild now. Chris is taking us into the deep dark. He's gonna get us lost and steal all our gear. Ooh. I can't get through that with my pack. Well, I guess there is a limit to your roller packs, guys. Yeah. Get a little beep going. All right, I'm gonna put the camera down and put it away so I can get through this and we'll talk.
All right, so this is my setup. It's the next morning. I woke up, it's 37 degrees. No idea what it got down to last night. But it wasn't so bad. I slept nice and toasty in my hammock. Here's my roller pack. My backpack emptied. But got strapped to a tree, wrapped a tarp around a tree with some cordage, and then I put my pack on it. That way I can peel the tarp down around it and keep any dew, morning dew, or rain off of it if it were to rain. And then I got my REI pack cover to cover the pack itself. Got my sleeping gear in the yellow bag, and then my hammock and everything, my sleeping bag, hammock, all that stuff fits in this bag here. And my tarp goes in its own bag. So down here, it's not too dark. Got my steel nylon weather shield that I made. Jacks are better. 800 fill down old rag mountain underquilt or top quilt. It can go either way. Eno single nest hammock and North Face 0 degree sleeping bag and homemade pillow out of the military poncho liner blanket with Velcro closure on a prusik up there so I can slide up and down my ridgeline for adjustment. And there you have it. Got a ridgeline for the hammock, a ridgeline for the tarp. And it's very nice and toasty. This is the Eno tarp with 2QZQs sewn on doors. Whoopee slings for the hammock. And just a big bright yellow cord for the tarp line. Jacks are better tree straps. And the Mediolus holds like several thousand pounds climbing D-rings. Prusik on the tarp line. With 10 pound S clips on either end. And don't need much more than 10 pound S clips for your tarp. Tarp don't weigh that much. So, alrighty. My candle lantern with the 9 hour candle. Lit it up last night, probably around 9 o'clock, I wanna say. And it stayed lit until 8:45 this morning when I actually got up and blew it out. And there's still candle in there. Probably would have gone another hour or so. So the 9 hour candle lasted at least 12 hours with some to go. And it's cold out, they last a whole lot longer. I also added the elastic shock cord pullouts here, and I don't know who makes these, I forgot, but I got a whole bag of them for like $5. I added these to the tarp myself, and they make great for pulling out the sides. So I've done a lot of alterations to this tarp, but for the better. I added the Jacks for Better shock cords to the tarp as well. And I use the MSR Groundhog stakes for staking it out. There's Medic Jim over there. And there's Howie and Chris, I think he goes by Hobbit. And Chris goes by Hobbit, right? Huh? Chris goes by Hobbit, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So there's Jim's hammock. The other two are tenting. Chris goes by hammock sometimes.
Howie's just a full-time grounder. Groundhog. That's what we'll call him now. So, alrighty. Alright, so I'm using my alcohol stove that I got from my friend that you saw a video on for the first time. Making some hot water for oatmeal and coffee. There it is. Going pretty good. Got that screen glowing orange. I'm using my GoPro, or not the GoPro, my reflector from, I can't remember where I got that from now. I'll have to tell you later. Anyways, a reflector from another alcohol stove. And it's doing a good job with it. So, anyways, working good. Works great with this pot. You can see the flames coming up around it all the way around. So, and we're all ready to go as soon as we're done with breakfast. They're standing around here bullshitting about movies. And I packed up my stuff first and then having breakfast. They had breakfast first and then packed up their stuff. So I wanted to get packed up while I was nice and warm.
Real long beer.
Right out of the bag. So
I mean, it's I'm like shaking.
And then I used the food to warm me back up. So, anyways, I think we're hiking off down that way today.
Your whole body and not some other part.
Oh, mostly downhill today, I'm told. So, alrighty, talk to you later. Alrighty, so we've been out hiking for a little while, and look at where we're at. Something weird following me. There's my pack. Doing pretty good. Kind of an unmaintained trail that we're on. We're going over a lot of logs. And then there's Jim grabbing a hold of my pack. Right. Give you a look at me going over the log real quick. Goes right over him, no trouble, no issues. Here's our fearless leader trying to figure out where we're at.
Okay, yeah, there it is.
The H is for the Hoover Howl.
You got it.
So there's our map.
We're here.
So we got about a mile, mile and a quarter to the vista.
And then down.
And then we'll drop down. We're dropping down.
How much further to go till the camp?
Oh, I'm figuring 5-6 miles.
Yeah, that ain't bad. We got all day to do that. That's 6 miles, that's like 2 hours, 3 hours.
This ridge over here, I think it was in...
Jim, it's like 4 or 5 hours.
98.
I'm just taking my time, enjoying myself.
Private plane crashed over there.
Oh wow!
The doctor from Elmira flew down to State College to visit his son in college, and then when he came back, he got off course in a blinding snowstorm and
went down
there. Yeah.
Any remnants left?
I've been over there. I can't find anything. Yeah.
I take it they found him though, and like packed him out. Cool. Did he survive or no? Die? I always wondered if I'd come across a body or an airplane out in the woods when I'm hiking on my big long trips. I'll go out for weeks at a time. I never come across anything other than garbage.
Well, it's too bad. I kind of take it to heart. I was in an airplane accident when I was a kid. Small plane?
Yeah, I think the lines are the one.
Hey. Well, we found a spot to take a break for lunch, whatever, hang out. Howie's pulling out his little homemade chair there. And I tried making one of those and just couldn't get it to work. But Medic Jim, I guess he goes by PA Woodsman now, pulling up the rear. Had to stop and pick some tea berries. And there's my roller pack. Getting some miles on it. Working out great. And I'm gonna make one modification to it, put a skid plate on the bottom side of it for going through rough terrain. But other than that, it's doing pretty good. I'm loving it. And it's a nice day. Great view. This area was burned down in 1964. And Chris was telling us about some silver mines around here. And Jim wants to poison me here. Mm-hmm. So
they don't have a whole lot of flavor.
Yeah, and, right now,
they weren't too flavorful even when they're.
Alrighty. Well, after our lunch break, we're back on the trail. And we'll be at our, let's say, a little after 12:30, we'll be at our campsite in about an hour. And I think we only got like 2.5-3 miles to go top. This is where we're at now. Heading off this way. It's Chris Hobbit up in front of us. Howie and directly behind me, and Jim way out there in the distance, if you can even see him in the camera. And there's our view to my left. It's Saturday afternoon. I don't know what the date is. November 15th or 16th, something like that. There's a mullein stalk for you. Here's the view to my right. My roller pack. As we were packing up for lunch, I noticed the upper buckles of my backpack where it attaches to my roller pack are loose. Nothing detrimental or anything. I just had to tighten them up. So may look into getting a better buckle. They're not the buckles that came with the frame. And they're not the buckles that came with the backpack. They're other buckles that I had got to attach the backpack to the frame. And I don't think they're quite strong enough, so they didn't break or anything. They just don't hold as strong. So I have some more different ones at home with a bigger bite to it that I'll think I'm going to switch out to. And just because I'd like to make sure that it's a stronger, more secure fit. And in the upper portion of the pack, it was still attached and everything else, but with the rigorous terrain that we were hiking on this morning, it kind of pulled loose a little bit. But it's all good now. Just keep the check on it once in a while and tighten it up. So, other than that, it's doing great. No issues with the roller pack at all. And this is a good test on this trail because we're getting pretty much every kind of terrain I'm ever going to be using this roller pack on, with the exception of deep snow. I'm putting the roller pack through its trials, and it's doing a good job. Hopefully you're actually seeing it, and I'm just staring at the map. Alrighty. Windy out here, so you're probably getting all that wind noise. There's a campfire, right? Got some stored wood. Here's a really cool sight. Somebody came down here and spent a lot of time building a nice little living room. There's their kitchen table there. And your benches for three. And your big fire pit here. I guess they made it big enough for a long fire. A little table there.
I think they
set these human sacrifices. Yeah. They got another stair over there. Any snakes in there? I'll pick one that doesn't have a thorny spine. Alright, if I get bit.
We'll calm with your body
later. Yeah. Yeah. It's actually got just the right pitch to it. Pretty comfy. Great view. Well, if I could find enough of these rocks, I would definitely build one of these in my on my property. For sure. That'd be cool. Alrighty. Just in case somebody falls in. I hear it cracking.
Yeah.
Bouncing on it don't help.
Yeah.
That's the one I heard cracking. Just don't bounce on it. Get up here and get a better view. I got an axe with me. We can make a little bridge if you want. No, I didn't take my roller pack on it. Put my roller pack down there across the rapid part.
Yeah.
And I just jumped across on the narrow.
I just don't have balance. I hiked with a buddy. He walked right up that one.
If I didn't have the roller pack, I could run back and forth across this all day long. Comes from building houses and running on the roof beams.
Wow.
I hear it snapping, man.
Yeah.
Come on, give us some action.
Shut up.
Damn.
Whoa! Almost caught your action.
Well, I don't want the action that's going to get you hurt. I just want the action that's going to get you wet.
Oh, I don't have any dry clothes with me.
Well, you know what they say. Pack a spare change of clothes.
I used to.
Spare change of clothes is not the thing you'd lose for the weight. Anyways. One more water crossing. You had to cross that down there. Luckily, not too wet. This trail's pretty easy going, except for the fact you keep wanting to slide down the hill. My pack's doing just great. My shoes, however, don't have the traction needed to stay on the trail. I keep sliding. But the roller pack staying on the trail nicely. No issues with that. It just follows behind me. Jim's way back there. And about a mile ago. Be nice to get up here in the sunshine where it's warm again. When we got down in this valley and the sun disappeared, temperature dropped about 15 degrees. Got chilly quick. Lots of poop, bear poop and whatnot, like coyote and as well. Full of seeds and fur. Maybe we'll get some visitors tonight. Alrighty, talk to you later. Alright, so somebody wanted to know how I do this tarp thing a while back. Now I'm finally getting to it. But basically what you do is you just wrap the tarp around the tree, and then in the middle, tie a rope around it to hold it to the tree, and then you just pick your pack up and attach it. You know, you would attach your pack, wrap your waist belt around the tree on your pack, clip it on just like you were wearing it, and then maybe have another rope around here if you had a regular backpack. And attach it. Then all you do is peel this down around it and covers your backpack. So if it's snowing, raining, sleet, hail, whatever, your backpack stays dry. The rain falls on the inside and whatnot. So I'll turn this off now, attach mine, and Jim's waiting to hang his tarp. And then I'll turn it back on and show
you. Now you can see that your pack is completely covered. Even if you have a rain jacket for your backpack, it only covers this portion of your backpack. It won't actually cover this side of your pack that rides on your back, and which can still get soaked by the rain. So you don't want to leave your pack on the ground. It's easy access for ants and all kinds of critters and whatnot to get into it. So the best thing to do is put it up on a tree like this. And here, if any rain or anything comes here, it's going to go in between the tree and the tarp. It's not going to get on your pack in any way, shape, or form. So, it's your pack is pretty well covered. Now, this, since I have the Dixon roller pack, here my harness is covered. And to get into in and out of my harness, I just lift it up, get into whatever I need, and then pull it back down. And this part of my pack here will be covered with my rain jacket. And because the bottom side of my pack is facing down, my rain cover will cover the top part, and any rain, snow, it'll be protected that way. But my pack, as you can see, is still up off the ground, so it's not going to get messed up in any way. So, alrighty, got to give you a look at it. This is just one of those cheap, it was $5 or $10 tarps from Walmart. Those steel nylons over in the camping outdoor products section. So. Alrighty, alright, got my hammock all set up for the night. Got my trekking pole there with the one corner up. When I go to bed tonight, I'll drop this corner down and cinch it up. But for now, so I can get in and out and do what I gotta do. Got it raised up to make it nice and neat. These doors on here do make a difference. And you can bring them out to make a beak, make more room if you need it, or you can close them up to make a little wall, however you want to do it. Right now the wind kind of feels like it's coming in from that direction, so I make sure the doors on this side are on the outside, overlap, so that the wind, when it comes this way, can't be scooped up and brought inside. Make sure the wind stays out. This discoloration right here is just where the tarp is wet. I carried the tarp on the outside of my pack, and the river crossings
Got it wet. So, it's all good. There it is. There's the hammock and the underquilt and all that good stuff. Here's the side, I got the bungee drawn out the side wall just to give you a little more space in there to wiggle around in. I don't like swinging back and forth and brushing up against the wall of this tent. So I like to have a little elbow room. Or tarp, not tent, sorry. With these doors on it, it kind of makes it like a floating tent. And I know somebody's gonna ask, can you set this tent, this tarp up as a tent on the ground? And you absolutely can. Just put a stake in right here where my pole is coming out. Just stake those four corners out and then stake out the doors right here where the bungee cords tie out, and set it up just like an A-frame tent. Use the trekking poles for your tent poles and they'd come out right here, and then run your guy line. The same guy line I've got right here, run it up the same way, only instead of to a tree, run it the ends to a stake in the ground. And you've got your tent. Very, very simple and easy to do without having to carry anything extra. And now all of a sudden you're laying on the ground. And then I would use my weather shield right here. I'd lay this on the ground, and then, well, I'd just put the whole hammock on the ground if I wanted to. Then I'd have my weather shield here, be on the outside. That would prevent any moisture from the ground getting into anything because it's 100% waterproof. And then the underquilt would provide a cushion and protection, somewhat of a cushion. I mean, it's not the same as having a mat, but, and then you got your sleeping bag. So, sleeping underground would be harder because I don't have an air mat, but in the event I had to, I could. I did on the Appalachian Trail on my last night. I slept on the ground. It wasn't that big of a deal for one night anyway. So I wouldn't want to do it every night. But, alrighty, I'm gonna go fix dinner, sit back and relax. Hopefully I can get dinner before the sun sets this time. So, enough chit-chat.
Alright, everybody. We got the folding firebox stove lit up. Burning nice. Jim's got his alcohol stove there. And Howie's using his alcohol stove. And Chris over there, he's got the caldera stove or something like that. What's that called?
Caldera type tray.
The caldera wood stove over there. Got a big pile of wood here. Getting ready to have some Parmesan noodles. Some pepperoni. Eating a Milky Way right now. Probably can't see it because it's too dark. Ate some cheese and Spam already. Hallie over there ate up all his food because he doesn't want to pack it out tomorrow.
I'm getting there.
Everything but his breakfast. One thing I suggest adding to this is a pair of prongs. Putting in your wood. Moving it around when it gets hot. There you go. Alrighty. Just about to boil.
Put my noodles on. So this is the Camelback All Clear, I think it's called. Doing his action at night. It's pretty cool. You just turn it on. Oh, there it goes. Let me start it up again for you so you can get another one. It goes for 60 seconds. And then once it gets going, you shake it back and forth. And turn on my headlamp. Once the light's on, it starts counting down. You shake it back and forth. I'm only doing it a second time so that you can actually see it on the camera. But it's pretty cool. It's the ultraviolet light, supposed to kill all the viruses and bacteria and everything in there. Make it all nice and clean for you. I don't trust it 100% because there's still stuff on the threads that you could get you sick. But whatever. I ain't too worried about it. So, pretty cool. You just shake it back and forth like this. Got all the instructions right here on the side. Max fill, line, hold button for 2 seconds. Agitate for the whole 60 seconds that the light is on. Then it's safe to drink after that. Wipe threads before drinking. And, yep, so there's my firebox stove going. Probably the only thing you can see are the flames right now. So, alrighty, it's only like just before 6, probably like 5:50 something. So, this will be the last one for now.
Alright, here's a look at the early morning where we camped out last night. The tenters over there. And Jim and I hung out on this group of trees here. My pack all set up. Been raining all morning. Stocked. We're about to head out now. Give you a look at the river down here, or creek or stream, whatever you want to call it. And there's a pool over here where you can go fishing. There you go. Get my water right down there. Alrighty, I'm gonna throw my pack on and head on down the road. 5 miles to the cars. We'll be out of here.